Gators have staked their claim for the national championship of the 1996 season.
Let's go to Lynn Swan.
Okay, Steve, congratulations. I think what's going to be a national championship for you, we've got to let you say how you feel at this moment.
Swanee, God has smiled on the Gators.
Second down and 10. Matthews rolling to his right in trouble. Can't find anyone. Now he throws it for Harrison. Houston, who makes the catch. He's in the open field. Harrison to the 20. They're not going to catch him. Touchdown, Gator.
Werfel dropping back the throw. Pumps and fires the ball over the middle. It's Doering. It's Doering. Got a touchdown. Doering's got a touchdown. Oh, my. Doering's got a touchdown.
One back down.
Hi, everybody. Dan Hicken, and we're ready to talk Florida Gator football at Spurrier's Gridiron Grille. By the way, Coach, congratulations. 2 years.
Thank you. Yeah. Dan, we had our two-year anniversary last night. Had a big crowd. Everybody had a good time, and we're fortunate that the restaurant's done well, and got to keep it up.
Oh, you got some awards, though, right, Coach, recently at the restaurant?
Oh, well, according to our general manager, Freddie Wiebe, I think we were one of the top 25 in the state.
Yeah. And congrats.
One of the tops in North Central Florida.
Well, we got Gators here everywhere that need no introduction. We got Chris Doering. We got Shane Matthews. We got the head ball coach. So we'll dive right into Florida Gator football. And Shane, I'll start with you. Yeah, I know you're a little more bullish. You like
the most pessimistic guy in the whole country is optimistic.
He likes his Florida Gator football team. He is talking that they are going to do better than at least anticipated this year. Why?
Well, I'm going on the analytics, the data or whatever. The best players on the team last year, Billy Napier and his staff were responsible for bringing them in. Mm-hmm. And he's brought in over 48 new players from last year's roster. So, I mean, you look at Montrell Johnson, ETN, Ricky Pierce, all these other guys, they were the best players. Mm-hmm. And I trust it. And I like Graham Mertz a lot. Mm-hmm. He reminds me of a quarterback that would have played for this guy. Smart. He's extremely smart. I've sat in on meetings. His football IQ is way up there. I think he's accurate. I think he anticipates. And I think they're going to be a good football team. They struggled in the front seven defensively. Mm-hmm. They actually look like an SEC defense now. I still think that's kind of a weakness. Give them another year or so. Mm-hmm. But you can't be any worse on defense. And I think they're going to win a bunch of games.
Can Graham Mertz get the ball downfield?
I would never go against anything Shane says. I mean, he when I talk about quarterback play,
yes,
you know, I look to him for his experience and right, knowledge about the position. So he's actually made me more optimistic, I think.
Okay.
I was a little pessimistic. Vegas win total at 5.5 wins just doesn't sound like something ever associated with a Florida football program. Mm-hmm. But I'm with Shane. I think Florida's on the right path. I think they've got the right guy with the right plan, making some headway in the recruiting trail. That 2024 class is amongst the best in the country, and been proud of DJ Lagway, what he's done to help recruit more guys. The problem is the schedule is incredibly tough this year and even more difficult in 2024. So I think they could be better and not necessarily show it reflected in win total increases mm-hmm. this year.
Coach, will Florida football fans will have the patience to wait this thing through?
I think so, because there's nowhere else to go. We got a coach that's got a 5 or 6 year contract, something like that. So we owe him a whole bunch. And but anyway, I'm optimistic we're going to be better.
Mm-hmm.
I think Shane said 8 wins. I'm sort of saying 7 and win a bowl game would be a heck of a year.
Yeah.
And that's the schedule is tough. It is tough. We play 2 Power 5 teams, and South Carolina is the only one in SEC that does that. Mm-hmm. Fans sometimes they don't look at schedule.
Out of conference, you mean?
Out of conference, yeah.
Two power fives, FSU and Utah. But so anyway, it's going to be fun to watch. It is. I think the leadership, the attitude, obviously got to be better than last year.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, last year we were sitting there. Let's see, 4. Right after we beat South Carolina, we were 6-4.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm saying, well, we got Vandy and FSU.
Sure.
we beat those guys. We got a chance to be 8-4. And I'm thinking South Carolina's going to lose their next two with Tennessee and Clemson, and just the opposite happened.
Yeah.
They won theirs, and we managed to blow that Vandy game and then lost again. So then had a losing record. So, you know, sometimes talent is not everything. It's the attitude and team spirit and leadership. And so if we've got some leaders on this team this year, it'd be very helpful.
That was the interesting thing to me, I think, is looking at November after you come off that Texas A&M win, maybe the best of the season. South Carolina was another great win. You're thinking, man, you can win all four of these and end up 8-4. Florida has to win games that they're supposed to win. Losing to Vanderbilt is not an acceptable option, and no disrespect to Clark Lee and the program they've created.
Right.
But what you've seen now is a bunching of teams in the SEC East. And you saw last year Tennessee feast on the SEC East. You saw South Carolina benefit by winning SEC East games. In the last year of the divisions, you know, is it going to be Kentucky? Is it going to be Missouri? Is it going to be Florida or South Carolina? I think Tennessee may take a step back this year too. So being able to win those division games, as Coach always used to talk to us about, are really is going to define what Florida's able to do.
Shane, what happened to Florida football? Why has it slipped, in your opinion, over the last 10 years? We've had some moments, but not really ready to win an SEC championship, which he did, and Urban did, and even be ranked. I mean, the Gators not being ranked is sort of stands out to me. When Coach Spurrier was the coach, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, you weren't ranked the first week
yeah.
and you were ranked every week after for the next 12 years.
Yeah.
That's a great question. I don't know the answer to that. I mean, obviously, I think the other teams in the league and the East have gotten better.
Okay.
But we still, I agree with Doering. When you look at in the East and you got South Carolina, Missouri, Kentucky, and Vandy, to me, we should win those games. You got to win those games. I think they win those games this year.
Okay.
And then you got your two cupcakes. That puts you at 6 wins right there. But, you know, we just got to get more consistent play. And I just think over the last 10 years, you haven't seen consistent play, whether it's at the quarterback position, on the defense side of the ball, just some of our athletes hadn't looked like the other team, you know, when they get off the bus. Mm-hmm. And I think we're getting closer to that now.
How does Florida not have a quarterback, though? That's the thing. You go from when Tebow left for that stretch of years, maybe with Trask somehow finding the field. He wouldn't have found the field if Felipe Franks hadn't gotten hurt. So you could have gone, you know, 12, 13, 14 years without having a quarterback as the flagship university of the state of Florida. It just doesn't make sense.
No, I agree. And I think a lot of it comes down to – I think people, and I was talking about this on my show, I look at the quarterback position different than most people. I know football's changed, but people look too much for this athleticism.
Oh, yeah.
How far you can throw it, how fast you can run, which honestly, those two things have nothing to do with playing quarterback. And too many guys that can throw completions are getting overlooked in high school and not getting that opportunity, like a Kyle Trask, for example.
Yeah.
I mean, Kyle can't
Where
run
would he have gone if he didn't go?
Right. But I mean, he would have, like Chris said, he may never have gotten that chance,
right.
but he's a heck of a quarterback because he can throw the football.
Yeah.
It comes down to, can you make decisions? Can you throw accurately and go play football?
What was the key to coaching the quarterbacks? Obviously, you were the best at it.
Well,
I mean, what?
I coached him a little differently, I guess.
Yeah.
Than most of these guys nowadays, and most of these teams nowadays, I don't even know if they try to call an audible. Occasionally, surely somebody calls one, don't they, somewhere?
Yeah.
But if we saw a defense we had a good play for and we had a bad one on, we'd change it and get to it. But all quarterback coaches don't coach the same.
Right.
That's what people don't understand. They just say, they just watch quarterback play and, oh, man, he's terrible. Or the defense is really good or something like that. But, no, we had all guys that had good common sense.
Mm-hmm.
I'd say with Shane and Danny, Terry Dean, Rex, Doug Johnson, Jesse Palmer.
Mm-hmm.
I saw him on The Bachelor last night.
Yeah.
Wait a minute, time out.
That's right.
You're watching, You're watching The Bachelorette.
I was flipping around.
Okay.
I saw Jesse
there, so I watched for about five minutes, and I went on something else. But, they all played with confidence, and, confidence. I think Arthur Ashe once said, preparation leads to confidence. Confidence leads to success.
Okay.
So preparation, and we threw a bunch in practice.
Yeah.
And I had these guys throw practically all summer before the season.
You're around it, and you played it, and you played for him. So how was it different for you in terms of when he was coaching you and what you see now in terms of how they're coached, how the quarterbacks are coached?
Well, a lot of, you got a lot of RPO, a lot of run game, which we didn't care about.
Right.
Well, that wasn't in style back
right.
then.
Right. We would throw for 45 minutes minimum of routes on air.
Okay.
And that's where you get your timing, your spacing, and things of that nature.
That doesn't happen now?
No, they'll throw for maybe a 10-minute period. Mm-hmm. I'm a huge proponent of let these other guys go down there and work on the run game or whatever. Give me my wide outs, mm-hmm. and let's throw for 30 or 40 minutes.
I think the problem is it used to be scheme would trickle down somewhat from the NFL to college to high school. Right. Now it's the other way around. High school is like, all right, let's put our best athlete with the ball in his hands every time
right.
and let him run around and make plays. And that got adopted by college and even into the NFL for some degree. So at some point, you know, the old comes back in style. So you're going to see more pro style at some point in time. You're going to see guys are asked to throw the ball from the pocket a little bit more. And I it really wasn't that hard. Coach used to talk about it all the time. Just throw it where they ain't, right?
Right.
So if you work on the timing, if you're on the same page with the quarterback and the receivers, and you have a guy that can make good decisions and throw accurately, it's really not that difficult.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I want to talk about the schedule. You guys all mentioned how tough the schedule is. But, you know, when you're really good, I don't think you notice as much how tough the schedule is. You know what I mean? Because you stack up well.
Do we ever wonder? I don't ever remember looking at the schedule going, man, this is tough.
Yeah. You know? I mean, you guys, I mean.
And I'm the same way now. Yeah. I look at our schedule, and I don't think it's tough.
Okay.
I think Georgia's very good. I think LSU is very good. Mm-hmm. I know
you
Florida.
You win any of the other ones?
I think we can win all the other ones. Because I watched Florida State on tape last year preparing mm-hmm. for the game. I'm like, this team's not very good. I think they beat one team with a winning record all year last mm-hmm. year. So I know they can make plays. I know they got some athletes, but and Kentucky, Doering loves Kentucky. He loves
and
Kentucky.
And you hate Kentucky.
I don't hate Kentucky.
Well, you
I
said
just,
something 2 years ago that you went viral on this sport.
Vandy.
Oh, because they couldn't complete Vandy. A pass. They couldn't complete a pass. So
you like Devin Leary, though?
I do like him.
Yeah.
But, you know, I just think Florida, when the schedule rolls out,
yeah.
on paper, we should be better than the teams I mentioned earlier.
How did you look at the schedule every year when you saw it? You didn't.
No, not really. Just one game at a time. So
yeah.
We usually
Coach
B. didn't talk about two games down the road. Now we just talked about the next opponent.
Yeah, yeah. You guys mentioned Georgia, two-time national champs. I pine for him coaching against Georgia and going 11-1. That seems like a long time ago for Florida Gator fans. But
I think from my perspective, yeah. growing up a Gator, you know, in the 80s when Georgia was dominating Florida,
yeah.
you know, it seemed like we were never going to win. And
right.
I was a high school senior when Coach came in 90, and I remember him emphasizing that if Florida was going to get to the goals that we wanted to achieve, it started with beating Georgia.
Yeah.
And you know, I don't know about you, Shane, but like every Georgia week felt a little special for us. And it got to the point where we won so often, I think in the eyes of the fans, it lost some of the importance because we just
yes.
assumed we were going to show up in Jacksonville and win.
Yeah.
But I think now it's been reestablished how important winning that game is.
Yeah.
I mean, I had to learn about the Georgia rivalry,
right.
being from Mississippi, right. but you know, we got to get back to beating them. It's going to be tough. I think they're going to miss Stetson Bennett way more than they think.
Right.
You know, I've been a big fan of his ever since mm-hmm. they inserted him against Arkansas and he brought him back mm-hmm. 3 or 4 years ago. The Duke can just he does things that, again, the general public,
plays, right.
the general public doesn't think he's very good
right.
because he's
smaller.
He's 5'10", 5'11". Right. But
yeah.
he's accurate and knows where to throw the football. That's all that matters.
Yeah. Yeah. And he was, and he can scoot too.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't realize how he's quick when he outran. I saw a play against Auburn, mm-hmm. like midfield, and he outran everybody mm-hmm. to the end zone right up the middle. It was impressive. Why did you, mm-hmm. you taught the importance of the Georgia game though to this school and to this,
well,
this
they,
program?
Yeah, they'd won 15 of the last 20,
yeah.
and they beat our teams 2 out of 3.
Yeah.
And I think prior to 90, any time the SEC was on the line, they beat the Gators.
Mm-hmm.
If the Gators were about right. to win one, we'd lose.
Right.
If they needed to win it, they'd always win. But anyway, we just talked about we are just as good as Georgia fellas. Mm-hmm. In fact, we're better than them, actually, because mm-hmm. The first year we're playing them, one of the media guys said, are you getting a little nervous because it's time to play Georgia? They got our number in Jacksonville.
Mm-hmm.
There's a curse on the Gators in Jacksonville. That's what they tried to tell mm-hmm. us. And I said, no, we're not worried about Georgia. I said, listen, we're first in the conference in offense. And we're second in defense, and I think Georgia is ninth and tenth in mm-hmm. offense and defense.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we don't beat those guys, it's just all on us. We just were pitiful. That's all you can say. And so we started beating them, and then we also knew the way they used to talk about us. After right. they'd beat the Gators, they'd say, we're tougher than those guys. They said, when the game comes around, they fold up their tent, and they act like they want to go home. Mm-hmm. And said, we'll fight them to the end. We want it more than they do. I said, I showed them all the clips. I said, that's how they're going to talk about you if you allow those guys to beat us. So we were always ready to play them, except that one game. It all went bad that mm-hmm. one year.
Right.
But I guess 11 out of 12 wasn't too bad.
Not too bad.
I'll say real quick, just to add to what Coach was talking about. I listened to you talk last night about that Alabama win in Tuscaloosa, your second game. You credited, what was the score, 17-13?
Yeah.
You credited the defense, you know, and so many times I think at Florida mm-hmm. we've focused on the offense and not the defense. Right. I think if there is going to be a resurgence this year, it's because of the mm-hmm. defense. The right. defense was terrible last year, couldn't get off the field on third down.
Right.
Not Patrick Toney's fault, they just didn't have the right players. I think they finally have that, and I think they have a superstar in Austin Armstrong taking over as the DC.
Young guy.
Yeah.
Very.
Well, his lineage, too, you know, along the lines of having learned it in Georgia uh-huh. and uh-huh. been in Louisiana with Coach Napier and most recently had that quick stop in Tuscaloosa. I mean, he's got everything you could want, and the energy level is really high, which I think they need on that side of the ball.
I'll say this about the coach, though, it in those games, and the thing that, you know, as a football fan, you watch all these different coaches come and go. And the one thing that always stood out to me about you, Coach, you would throw it when you didn't, you'd be on your own goal line. You play action down the field. Turnover on that side of the 50, we're going to the end zone, man. That stuff is just.
Well, that was, the 90 Alabama win that was huge for us.
Yeah.
Because,
yeah.
You know, we blocked a punt mm-hmm. for the final seven yeah. points.
Mm-hmm.
And we threw out of our end zone. Shane hit Ernie Mills on a deep one. I was in third quarter. Mm-hmm. But we're down 10-0 at half and came back and beat Alabama at their place.
Yeah.
So that gave us a lot of confidence that we could play with anybody. And so it was a big win for us.
You know where the confidence came from? Playing for this guy.
Yeah.
You mentioned it.
Yeah.
Florida State, 95. It's 3rd and 17 from our own 3. We're going 5 wide and convert by throwing a cover 2 post over right. the field. We weren't afraid. We didn't
Not
play
afraid.
With any fear. And I think that's, you know, getting back to what Coach mentioned is like, we got to play with a little bit of
more of that swag. Yeah. I wrote these numbers down in 96, you know, 611 points we scored that year. Last year's team scored 384, but you talked about the defense. That defense in 96 gave up 221. Last year's defense gave up 375. I know there's a couple more games, but nonetheless, that's a big disparity. I think defense is important. You feel like one thing that Napier's done is get more SEC-type players that weren't coming here in the last few years as being one of the problems, I think, of Florida football, right?
Well, I mean, the crazy thing, not just Coach Napier, just the last 3 or 4 years, we've been so poor on the defensive side of the ball. And with all the great athletes just in the state of Florida,
right. mm-hmm.
Florida was always good on defense at some point in some capacity. And we haven't been very big up front mm-hmm. the last few years. We're much bigger now with the transfer portal and signing guys. But I agree with Chris. I love Austin Armstrong. Mm-hmm. You know, he wears a visor, Coach. But he's got great energy, and I think he's going to change mm-hmm. it for the good.
Yeah.
I mentioned, you know, how can Florida not have a quarterback in the state? How can Florida not have D linemen? I mean, as Shane mentioned, we've always been known to having great defensive linemen.
Right.
It's the most important position on the field because there's only a finite amount of guys that are that size and that agile and that strong that can do the things you need them to do in the SEC. And so Florida had a bad time getting those guys to stay in state. You know, goal number one for Florida, Florida State, and Miami is keeping the talent in the state, out of Alabama, out of Clemson, out of LSU, out of Georgia. And they've got to start by getting those defensive linemen. But I think, you know, Shane mentioned that we got some guys that look more like what SEC defensive linemen need to look like.
So you like Graham Mertz a lot. You think he's going to play well, and that's great. Who will be catching the ball for Graham Mertz? Is there enough there? Yeah. Because they got some young kids who are going to have to step up, right?
The three true freshmen really impressed me. And I kind of said they remind me of Ike, Quezzy, and Riedel a little bit.
I quoted you the other day on that.
Yeah, well, they're a little different, you know, because all three of those guys were different.
Yeah.
But Eugene Wilson III, Trey Wilson, however you want. I mean, he is the shifty little dude. Now, we haven't had anybody that had wiggle on the outside make people miss in a long time. Mm-hmm. And Andy Jean can fly.
Yeah.
And Pearsall, to me, I think he is a tremendous receiver. and he looks much quicker and faster this year to me.
Word is he's been uncoverable. I haven't been to practice yet, right. But they say he has not.
Which is very true. They've been running him on a lot of like option routes out of the slot.
Okay.
And I don't know if that's good that we good or bad that we can't cover him. But, yeah. But he's just really shifty right now, and it seems like him and Mertz are all on the same page.
What did you look for in receivers? Because you had so many great ones, including this young man who was a different story in his own. But what did you look for in terms of high school kids making the tramp? Was it speed? Was it size? You had all different types, like Shane said.
Well, like we were talking about, we practice all the time.
Yeah.
We throw. But run good routes and catch the ball. Run exact routes and catch the ball. That's with obviously pretty good speed,
mm-hmm.
and so forth. And, you know, maybe make some tough catches, you know, when you're about to get hit or right before or something like that. But not quarterbacks were not supposed to lead a guy into trouble. Right, Shane?
Mm-hmm.
So very seldom did they, you know, mm-hmm. head on. We didn't believe in that. But just the ability to get open and catch the ball, you know, obviously speed helps.
I would be remiss if I didn't ask for each of your opinion on this, what's happening in college football today. You know, this with the conferences and the changes and, mm-hmm. you know, some of it seems ludicrous to me. But, I mean, if Washington is coming across the country to play Rutgers at the end of the year, they're not playing Washington State, for example, or whatever, the Big Ten and the way the SEC is growing. Where do you guys stand on all
that? I think the biggest thing for me, and I've heard, I think Coach Drank at Missouri made a very good statement the other day, is like, where are the adults in the room? Where are the yeah. people that are supposed to be making decisions for what's best for mm-hmm. the sport mm-hmm. in general, for what's best for the individual athletes, for their families? You know, it's become such a money grab, unfortunately, that we're losing a lot of what's made college football so great. And that's
right.
the rivalries, the history, the traditions. Just 2020, we were talking about during the pandemic, all these athletic budgets that were hanging by a thread
right.
and becoming more regionalized. And now we're talking about, you know, flying, as you said, across the country to yeah. play Rutgers as a school in Washington. Like, mm-hmm. that doesn't make sense. What about all the non-revenue producing sports?
Well, that's the issue, right? Yeah. I mean,
yeah. yeah. Several coaches have even mentioned that if Washington, Oregon, and those Southern Cal, UCL, if they want to go in football, that's fine.
It's right. Yeah, it's a charter.
Four or five right. times a year, they right. go back and forth. But the other sports, they should stay on the West Coast.
Right.
Keep the Pac-12. And let the softball mm-hmm. and the volleyball and the swimmers and the baseball and the basketball, let them keep playing their traditional.
We already do that in lacrosse, right? Don't we play in the Big East in lacrosse? Yeah. Why couldn't you do that?
So should football mm-hmm. separate, maybe?
I hate to see that, but it makes sense.
It makes sense because
in football, I mean, let's be honest, flying across the country is no big deal.
Right.
You know, charter flight, you fly, spend the night, play the game, fly right back.
Right.
The other sports can't do that.
Right.
And I don't like it at all. I guess because I'm a traditionalist.
Yeah.
But, you know, I remember, and Chris, I'm sure Chris's parents, my mom and dad used to go to every game we played.
Right.
You know, even after a high school game on Friday night, you know, they wouldn't leave Mississippi until 1 o'clock in the morning and drive right. wherever. You can't do that now if your kid's mm-hmm. playing college athletics.
Yeah.
And talk about breaking away. I mean, we've already seen that in college football. The championship is not handled by the NCAA. It's handled
right.
by the college football playoffs.
Right.
So, you know, why not take that next step and let the entity like the college football playoffs handle the entire sport for the entirety of the season. We can't even get the right number of conference games being played between, you know, what the SEC and the Big Ten and those folks are playing.
I think for me as a fan, like Saturdays, I'm always there, right? Saturday, I mean, I love the game. We all love the game, right? You guys played the game, coached the game. We love the game. But, you know, you get turned off by all this off-season stuff. Last year we were sitting here talking about NIL and how much is too much and nobody has a grip on it. And, you know, I know that some of these schools have come together and tried to figure it out best they can. But, I mean, so and that now we turn around and we go, well, forget the kids. What about the – it's all about money. Money.
Why is the NBA not popular? Because there's no connection to these European players that come over and play. There's right. no connection to a one-and-done. Like, we love the NFL because we can cheer for those guys that played at our schools. Now, we don't even know who the guys are that are playing for our schools.
And right.
They come in for one season. You don't have any real connection to them. You haven't watched their development. So, in so many different ways. And I hate, you know, I am very appreciative to Coach for what he did in terms of my whole career. But mm-hmm. giving me that scholarship meant something to me. Not
yeah.
only was it a legitimizing of me as a player, but, you know, to get an education, I made more money in my post-playing days by having that diploma on my wall from the University of Florida than I ever did as a football player. And I think these kids don't realize, one, the value of that, and two, the experience that you'll take away from being at the University of Florida.
Yeah, I agree. When,
say, 2028, 2030, and all these guys that went one school here, one school there.
Right.
All right, now they're out of football. I think, what, 3% make an NFL or get a chance to play pro football,
right,
and only about 3 years is the lifespan of an NFL player now. So all of a sudden, they're going to say, well, now, all right, I'm out of football now. What am I going to do? And, well, do I go back to my school or this one or that one or that one? Where am I going to live? So I don't know. I just wish, you know, they could have a home to come back to. And I used to tell our guys, stay here 4 or 5 years, do well, graduate, and then you always got a home to come back to.
Yeah. As coaches, you would have to adapt. Mm-hmm. But could you imagine coaching today where you have to recruit high school kids, mm-hmm, which you did well, re-recruit your own players, and then recruit the portal? I mean,
it's nuts.
It never ends. I mean, how would that be for you today?
Well, you know, Alabama, I guess they have a few guys leave, yeah, here and there.
Georgia does the best.
Georgia, yeah, Georgia doesn't have many.
Retaining, yeah, their roster.
Yeah. Yeah,
that's true. They don't have many.
And how do they do that, Chris?
I mean, I've talked to Coach Smart about it before, and it's the attention and time that they give each of their players, staying connected with the family. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of them understand. I mean, the Bear Alexander move was surprising for, mm-hmm, him to leave, but it was another one of those money grab, get the bag situations. Mm-hmm. But I think you look at the opportunity to play for championships, the opportunity to get developed and get drafted in the NFL.
It's a big deal, that part. Yeah. I mean, Georgia's sending a lot of guys.
And they pay them all a little bit, too.
Oh, yeah?
They pay them all a little bit, too.
Yeah.
So,
which is legal now, yeah, supposedly. Yeah. So,
$25,000,
yeah,
I think,
is, yeah,
their normal pay, which is perfectly legal.
Uh-huh. All right, so you think the Gators are going to do pretty well. Give me your official prediction looking ahead.
I sit at 8-4 right now. It could be better.
Okay.
Could be better.
Could be better.
Could be better. There'll be celebration. I mean, it'll be like
we'll be tearing down the goalposts.
But I'm like, Chris, we get Tennessee at home. Tennessee has not had much success in the swamp.
Right.
And, dude, let me tell you something. I don't care how far Joe Milton can throw a football. Uh-huh. I've seen him play.
Okay.
I saw him play at Michigan. Heupel benched him, mm-hmm, when he initially got there. Now, Hendon Hooker was a heck of a player,
right,
but I think Tennessee takes a step back.
Okay.
Coach, you like what Coach Heupel's done, right, in terms of developing?
Yeah, they've done well. They've done well.
He was the co-winner of the Steve Spurrier First-Year Coaches Award a couple years ago here. But I think that's one of the fascinating things to me is what's done in the offseason from defensive coaches and preparing for certain offenses.
Right.
I think a lot of folks have watched a lot of film on Tennessee this year and have a lot of plans for how they can provide some wrinkles to stop what they've done.
Because it's interesting. I mean, it's all about going fast for them. Because it's not his type of passing. There's one read and one read only in their offense.
That deep choice route is pretty interesting, though, the way that they run some of that
stuff. No, it is.
Tell folks what that is so they understand.
So it's usually a two-man combo where they have one guy that's tagged as the choice runner, and the other guy is just designed to take the safety out of the middle. And now you have leverage, you know, if you're even, you're leaving, so you're running the go route.
Right.
If you have the corner on the outside, you're running the post, or, you know, if you're playing in that big zone or the guy's on top of you, you're sitting it down. So they do it from the inside and the outside. But I think what you'll see this year, you'll see teams using more three safety looks. I think you'll see them try to be more physical with Georgia had a great blueprint for how you're physical with the receivers. Jalen Hyatt did nothing in that game. And the way they rushed the quarterback, because they're reading it, all right, he got to be ready to throw at 10 yards or you're throwing a deep ball. Their steps in the pocket are so much more shallow. So what you saw Georgia try to do is bring pressure up the middle to try to dent the pocket to, you know, either sack the quarterback or affect his ability to throw. So you'll see a lot more of what Georgia did this year. The question is, do they have the players to execute the plan the same way?
And you feel like Florida's seven wins, maybe a bowl game?
Yeah. Hopefully, I think a winning season and win the bowl game. I like to add that. Right now, the bowl game hadn't meant much around.
That didn't go very well.
Well, think about what that's done to set the tone for the next year. Terrible game in Vegas. Terrible, the OU loss may have been the downfall of Dan Mullen's time here. Yeah. So, you know, finding a way to reinforce it's important to play in a bowl game is going to be a big task for Coach Baker.
I've said when the Alabama players start bailing out that it's okay to do it.
Yeah.
Bryce Young, the number one pick, and Anderson, the number two pick, they all played in the bowl
game.
So why don't the other guys?
Yeah.
Well, congratulations on all your success.
Oh, thank you, man.
Coach, it's always great to see you. Congratulations on the restaurant. Yeah. 2 years, going strong. Look great. Shaner, analysis, Gator style, all season long. We enjoy listening to you.
Pretty fun.
All right, that'll do it for this edition of this year's Roundtable. Thanks, man.
All right, man. Hey!